I just have a short little lecture for you on Lewin field theory and the life space. So according to Kurt Lewin, the life space consists of all events in our past, present, and future that help shape our personalities and affect us. Each of the events helps determine our behavior in any given situation we're in. The life space also consists of a person's needs and interaction with the psychological environment. So to put this into our own words, we would say that each of us comes into this world into a life space. The events that shape us begin before we're born, begin in our genes, and they continue to shape us throughout our lives. And so both the accumulation of these events in our lives and the particular situations that we're in determine our behavior in any situation. And as we'll see shortly, the life space also includes some of those thought patterns or the shaping that we've done in our own brains. So this is a gestalt theory in that the life space is considered a whole dynamic system that's greater than the sum of its individual parts. So we would not be able to take the individual, if we wanted to recreate you, we would not be able to say, take all of the individual factors that have been a part of your life space and put them together and get you. You are bigger than just a sum of all those pieces of your life space. And so this explains why twins or even identical twins differ in their behaviors, because they've had small variations in their life space that shape them differently, even though their genes are identical. Within this life space, Lewin would offer that there are force fields, fields that motivate us or push us in one direction or the other. And we will look at a slide illustrating this in a moment, but let's think about what those fields might be. So the force fields might include places, people, and events. Where were you born? What was the environment? Who was living with you when you were born? Do you have siblings, pets? What events happened in your early childhood that might have shaped you? Did something frightening happen? Did you have a great deal of love? And in addition to these real lived experiences, we have vicarious life space. This is our headspace. Video games would be a large part of that life space today, and social media. In my childhood, it would have been books, paper books that influenced me strongly. And then later, when I was in my teen years, music and movies. But all of these are also part of your life space. And so part of the physical life space are these force fields that we've just described. And we also have cognitive schemas, like the beliefs that are passed on to you from your elders and from your family and from your school, and the stereotypes that are imposed on you, and the perceptions that you take on because others in your environment hold those perceptions. So these are the plans and the vectors that influence your decisions. These include your emotions, so the amygdala reactions and the somatic experiences, or the physiological or physical experiences that are linked to these emotions. And finally, they include the cognitive distortions that we talk about in a separate lecture, or the biased thought processes that have become habituated in our thinking. So we have these physical force fields and these cognitive force fields that shape us. And then whether we're going to have equilibrium or balance, or I don't know if you would say hosho, it depends on whether the forces that are driving us in this particular direction are balanced with the restraining forces. So maybe we're hoping to change, for example, and there are certain force fields that are moving us toward those change, but to what extent are they counterbalanced by the restraining forces? If they're balanced, the change will not occur. If the driving forces are greater than the restraints, the change will occur. Now, force fields affect people in different ways, and there is a sort of a dichotomy that we use to describe the extent to which these force fields affect people. One is called field independence, people who are fairly independent of the forces in the world around them. And the other is field dependence, people who are more dependent on the forces in the world around them to shape their behavior. Field independent people have an impersonal orientation. An example that was given to me when I first learned about this was, imagine that you have to walk into a big social gathering, a big room full of people, and you're looking for someone in particular for an important reason. Would you be able to what extent would you be able to head directly to that person, ignoring all that's going on around you and not being influenced by it? Or would you be heavily influenced by what's going on around you? So that's one way that it was presented to me initially. Maybe that's helpful to you. But this impersonal orientation is able to ignore all those kind of physical force fields, social force fields, and stay with their internal frame of reference or their goals that they have within themselves. And this will also help them processing information and make a decision. Field independent people tend to be analytic. That is, they're able to break out the component parts of a field and distinguish it from what's going on in the background. They're easily going to be able to go find that person at the party and not get caught into the background. And they're also going to be fairly independent. They have a sense of themselves as separate and unique and distinct from other people rather than being part of a coherent whole. Field-dependent people tend to have a personal orientation. That is, they're going to rely on more of those external fields to process information. And when they come into the party to look for their friend, because they're perceiving the field as a whole, they're going to have a harder time just pulling out and ignoring all that background and finding their friend. The sense of self is derived from others, and so this person is dependent on others to form the sense of self. The way that we test this is this odd little test. So you might ask someone, you might give people images of rods that are vertical, that is pointed directly up and down in a vertical orientation, and rods that are at an angle. And you might be asking people which rods are vertical, but around each rod would be a life space, and it would be a background that is either at an angle or is vertical. It's called the rod and frame test, and so you need to either align this rod within the frame so that it's vertical, or you choose the one that's vertical. So are you able to, are you distracted by the background? In this first image, where the rod is aligned with the background, does that seem more vertical to you, or are you able to ignore the background and make the rod vertical within this objective environment? Field independent people would be making the rod vertical irrespective of this background shape, whereas field dependent people would tend to make it vertical in alignment with the background shape. And that is what I just described in writing. And it does make a difference, and we shouldn't weigh out one as better than the other. So field independent people, again, can separate details from the context and tend to be more independent, competitive, and self-confident, perform better in a deductive lesson, that is taking facts and drawing conclusions, and they can analyze, pay attention to details, and they can really do well with drills, so they're kind of detail-oriented. Whereas field-dependent people would be more socialized, more empathic, more perceptive of the feelings and thoughts of others, more aware of the social environment, which is also good. Perform better in inductive lessons and have good control of communicative aspects of interactions. So once again, both have a place, both have a value. And then we just jump into one last idea here that's not plugged in particularly well, but a little bit. And this is the idea of reciprocal determinism. And by reciprocal, we generally mean bidirectional. So this is a model of how we are shaped. And so we would say that the relationship between the environment and the person is reciprocal. So there would be, let's say, a person who has personality characteristics they're born with, cognitive processes that have been shaped, and certain abilities to regulate their behavior and regulate their emotion. And these personal factors influence the environment. It influences what stimuli are present in the environment and what reinforcement contingencies are needed to strengthen or diminish a behavior. And so in turn, this environment shapes the person. So they might learn to regulate themselves based on the contingencies. Likewise, this person engages in certain behavior. So the nature of the behavior, the frequency and the intensity of the behavior are shaped by the person, but in turn that person's behavior is self-reinforcing. As this person engages in those processes again and again, those same traits are strengthened. And finally, the environment shapes the behavior. So the determination of what happens, nature, frequency, and intensity of what the individual does is shaped by what's present in the environment, which in turn, their behavior shapes the environment. So if the individual, let's picture a child, engages in frequent, intense, extreme behavior or problems, then there are going to be more reinforcement contingencies in the environment to respond to that. And maybe it's a highly stimulating environment, which contributes to these behaviors. So we would say reciprocal determinism in terms of shaping what decisions a person makes and who that person is. And on that note, we end this presentation.